Everyone, welcome to our 203rd meeting. This is the latest in our regular monthly meetings. Tonight, we are going to be hearing from, oh my goodness, I'm going to get this wrong. I just should have asked you before. How would you like to, thank you. Okay. Andrea Arcangeli, with a talk about the Linux kernel. We like to have a periodic talk about sort of the state of a piece of the Linux kernel or anything interesting we can. And this year, Andrea is kindly providing this for us. The talk, as you all probably know, is Virtual Memory Management and Virtualization in the Linux Kernel, a topic of interest for Andrea and I guess for everyone here. I'd like to say how much first. We appreciate Bloomberg for sponsoring us with this space, and thank you to all of you for coming here. You know, we like to provide this opportunity, and when you take the opportunity to join us, it makes the event happen. So again, thank you very much. Tonight, before we get started, we have our usual requests. First, silence your cell phones. Second, do not eat snacks in noisy wrappers. This is less of a problem in this space, but I still want to mention it. And third is, please use the microphones for questions. This permits anybody who watches this later on YouTube or wherever to actually hear your questions as well as the answer. Our next meeting will be Wednesday, April 20th, and that one will be What's New in Ubuntu 16.04, Xenial, I believe, Xeris. Someone tell me if that's, has anyone heard that word pronounced live by a biologist? No, I'm going to assume that's close enough. All right. I'd like to thank our regular space sponsor, Bloomberg, and acknowledge our other sponsors, past and present. Those are IBM, Canonical, Brandor Group, Google, and O'Reilly Media for their support. In addition, NYLUG would not be able to function without our volunteers. They've contributed and continue to contribute constantly. Announcements. Does anyone have announcements about events that are going on that they'd like to get up here and have the podium for a moment? And I don't see anybody. I see someone putting up their coat, but I don't think that's an announcement. Okay, the next NYLUG workshop, please talk to Rob. Rob may be out front, or David here. The next one, I believe, should be March 29th from 6 to 8 p.m. At City College on 138th in Amsterdam. You can see it on the NYLUG meetup page if you want more information. And in case you missed it, you can grab a Linux distro DVD from the table out front. Those are free for you to take. If there's a distro you are interested in and the DVD would help you, go ahead and take it. Now, we didn't talk about this, but I think normally it works best for questions to be taken at the end or at markers. Andrea will tell you when he is ready for a question. Please don't come up and interrupt. That will probably be best. At the end of the presentation, there will be trivia questions asked by Andrea with material from the presentation. The prizes will be your choice of one of the four books that we have. They are over there if you want to take a preview of them or if you can see them from where you are. So at the end of the talk, someone will help you out with, will help him out as he will ask the questions. You will give the answers. Four people will walk away. All right. So here we go. Please welcome Andrea Arcangeli with Virtual Memory Management and Virtualization in the Linux Kernel. That's a tongue twister. Thank you very much.
Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for inviting me. And so we are going to talk about some of the milestones in the evolution of the virtual memory subsystem today. And I've been involved into the Linux virtual memory for probably 17 years, or anyway, it's a long time. And I've had the privilege to see all the changes which happened over the years in the Linux virtual memory subsystem. And of course, in the second part of the presentation, I will also show you some of the latest innovations, like NUMA balancing, like userfaultfd, a lot of developments in the transparent huge pages part of the kernel, and also KSM. And so there's a lot of development, of course, going, and we'll see some of it. So to start, I'm going to show you a little bit how what we mean with virtual memory. Virtual memory is where all your applications are running. And virtual memory costs absolutely nothing. It's free. It's an abstraction given to you by the CPU. And then there's physical memory. That's the one you actually buy, and it actually costs money, and you plug it in the computer. And then there's something in between, which is a layer of, I picture them as arrows. They are the page tables. And the page tables are like a metadata that the CPU offers the operating system to set up. And all the algorithms inside the Linux kernel are all about setting up this layer for you. So you can run your programs, and you don't notice that you're not running on physical memory, and you're running on virtual memory. But for you, it looks just if it was real. And this layer of page tables is structured like a tree. So you have 512 pointers for each one of these layers. In the picture, it's only two, because otherwise the picture gets big. And each one of these page tables in red is 4K size, just like it would be the final page size. So they are all the same page size, and they take a lot of memory. So, this virtual memory is not free, too. You need to use memory for these page tables and for all the data structure which manages the memory itself. This page table layout is also interesting because it gives you the maximal amount of virtual memory you can map at any given time in a certain processor. So on the x86-64, with this format, that will be 48 bits. So there's no way to use more than 48 bits of virtual memory, of which 47 are positives, and if another 47 bits are negative. And there's no way to use more than that, just because of this layout. So the most interesting thing to show in how the virtual memory changed over the years is to show the changes specifically to the fabric of the virtual memory. And with fabric, I mean all this data structure which connects the page table to the abstraction you are normally accustomed to use, like tasks, processes, pointers, and syscalls like mmap, which are actually used by malloc or any new in C++ or any allocation. So eventually, all these abstractions goes down to setting up page tables. And the fabric is actually the most black and white part of the virtual memory subsystem. So I can actually show you the data structure. Better can I show you the changes in the heuristics which compute on top of these data structures, because these heuristics are solving problems which don't have a guaranteed perfect solution. And for example, one of the problems which is very hard to solve is when is the right time to start swapping. And we actually don't have a perfect solution for that. There are heuristics which do an excellent job at finding the answer, but even those have tunings like swappiness. So there's this swappiness syscontrol in /proc sysvm swappiness that you can tune and increase or decrease if you want more or less swappiness. And some things, however, actually never changed in Linux from a design standpoint. For example, one of the very winning design choices, which was done long, long time ago, was, for example, to use all the free memory as cache. We never actually have a limit on the cache. Whatever is free in the memory, we try to make good use of it. So we never leave anything for waste. And another thing which has never changed is a very significant overcommit by default. So by default, when you allocate memory, we give you potentially more memory than what's available in the total RAM plus swap. And if you want even more aggressive overcommit, you should use this echo 1 in the /proc sysvm overcommit memory. That's incidentally what Android does. So Android is setting this up by default. If instead you want to never run into the RAM killer, you should set number 2 in this file. If you use number 2, then you are not using overcommit. But practically nobody does. And everybody actually leverage the overcommit behavior of Linux, despite it gives you the risk of having to run into the out-of-memory killer later. So the most important data structure in Linux is the page structure. And that also is one of the structures which has always existed. And the page structure is 64 bytes. So this page structure describes the state of a page. You know, each page on the x86 architecture and in most other architecture is 4K in size, so 4 kilobytes. And these 64 bytes are required for each page, which means 1.56% of all the memory of all the cell phones, all the servers, and everything running Linux out there is allocated as struct page. So we are effectively losing this memory. And this is one of the most complex structure in the kernel. Not so much from a semantic standpoint, but purely from an implementation standpoint, because we are doing huge, huge tricks to prevent this structure to grow. Because growing 8 bytes in this structure would mean losing globally several petabytes of memory. If you count all the, if you count 1 billion of cell phones, probably, I don't know, dozens of millions of servers with 32 gigabytes or more, I mean, so there's a huge waste by just increasing this structure 8 bytes. So we constantly run out of flags. And we always find other ways to push some old flags in some other logic, so we get one more flag free to use for the new feature. And these struct pages are allocated in this array called memmap. So a little bit of the memory in the physical memory will be used as this array of struct pages. It's just a plain array. In the old days, this was purely flat, contiguous. Now it can be also discontiguous, but that's not conceptually different. Other critical structure are the mem structure and the VMA. So the mem structure is effectively describing the memory of the process. So when you fork, you create a new process, that gets a new mem. And then when you actually malloc the memory, or you call mmap to mmap a file, you tend to create a VMA. So I'm really simplifying things, but that's pretty much what happens. The VMA is the virtual memory area structure, and it's created when you do mmap, and it's teared down when you mmap. It effectively defines a range where you get the memory in this range, and the kernel tracks this range through this structure. So in the old days, what we had, then I'm really talking long time ago here, it's like kernel 2.2. And in the kernel 2.2, we had just something I call page recline clock algorithm. I checked it actually online because I didn't remember for sure if it was really the name, and I think that was really the name. I verified it. So it's really simple. It's a loop over the memmap array. And we loop all over the pages in the system. We were trying to search if any page was like cache, unmapped cache, and we could free it. So there was no cleverness in trying to have any order of this scan. It was just a continuous loop. In the background, we would scan the memory whenever we were low on memory to try to free it. Potentially, we would also loop over pages. We were kernel pages. There was no chance to free those. So it was really, really inefficient. And then there was a page table scan, because that is the physical scan. We also had a page table scan, which is the one in green, which worked pretty much the same way, except instead of scanning this page structure to try to free cache, which was unmapped, it was just trying to get rid of the mappings, which are the page table mappings in the red arrow, because as long as there is some mapping, even if this was cache, like page 0 or page 1, there was no chance this could be freed. So to free the pages, first we have to get rid of the mappings of the page tables, and only then we can finally free the page. So if you think about the cost of freeing page 1, which had two mappings with these two arrows, potentially we had to scan the whole page table in the whole system before we could actually free page 1. And that clearly cannot scale. I mean, if we had terabytes of virtual memory to scan just to free one page, there's no way this algorithm could scale today. And this was the status in the 2.2 kernel. So the next step in the evolution of the virtual memory was to introduce the first LRU. And it actually sounds extremely trivial today to think about LRU is so simple, right? But at the time, there was not. And when we added it, we got the first bit of scalability in the shrinking of the memory of the VM, in being able to do the reclaim more efficiently. So the LRU provided us with an order. So we had the tail and the head, And we could actually follow the whole LRU and effectively keep an order and being able to tell which pages were more important and which pages were less important instead of doing just a loop, a blind scan. But we still had the page table scan, which was extremely inefficient. So even though we were more efficient at the page level, we were still very inefficient on unmapping pages. Unmapping means dropping the page tables, the red arrows. The next step in the evolution has been to introduce the active and inactive LRU. And that happened during 2.4 kernels. The active and inactive LRU effectively solved the problem in how the LRU was getting polluted by the I/O. So if you have a streaming I/O, like, I don't know, a backup, for example, if you run a backup, which is reading all the hard disk, and it keeps adding memory to the page cache, and it keeps adding this memory to the LRU keeps rolling, and it rolls very fast, and it trashes away all your working set. The whole LRU quickly gets full by the backup data. And the active and inactive list LRU provided a way to preserve the working set. So the preservation of the working set happened by moving these working set pages from the inactive to the active list. So when we moved this page from the active and inactive list, they had a better chance to be preserved, even though the pollution from the background I/O, which had no way to fit in the cache, of course, would keep staying in the inactive list. So the I/O would be contained into the active list, and the inactive in the active list, we would keep all the working set alive in the cache. And as you can see, this was actually a very old bitmap picture. So it's the original one I did back then. If we check the next slide, this will be the same chart as before, but with the two LRUs. So the inactive LRU is the one which includes the used one pages that basically are like trash because they don't fit in the cache. And before they're used again, they will be reclaimed. So it's basically useless to keep it in the cache, but we give them a chance by keeping them in the active LRU. And then there's the active LRU with the used many pages. And the used many pages, of course, what it means is the first time you access it, you are doing I/O. The second time, it's already in the cache. So it's just quick. You don't do any I/O. And of course, when you have a lookup, which is a cache lookup, which gives you a hit, you are going to put this page into the head of the list, so it's not reclaimed immediately. Inactive and active LRU lists, LRU stands, of course, for last recently used. It gives the order of the importance of the cache, are very visible in any system out there by just checking /proc/meminfo. And one thing I should also mention here is we had an algorithm to keep these lists in balance because we need to keep these lists of a certain size depending on the workload. And this algorithm, which was implemented initially, kept this list about the same size. So the objective was to keep about the same size, and it still worked very well. But the very good solution for the balancing algorithm was solved only a couple of years ago, around 2012, 2014, by using metadata objects, metadata nodes in the shadow radix tree, tracking refaults. So now we are really, really good at sizing these active and inactive lists. So even though this concept started long ago, we got many optimization going recently, even on these things. So I'll keep going with the slides. So what was the problem left? The problem left was the page table scan, clearly, because from the page reclaim side, so for the map array shrinking, things were pretty optimal at this point, especially after we got the latest solutions. But the page table scan was still extremely inefficient. Suppose we still had to freeze this page one, which had two mappings, we still had to scan all the page tables. And that might work for a small system like we had back then, but there's no way this could work in, I don't know,
100 gigabyte or especially 1 terabyte system, because there's too much virtual memory. Besides, virtual memory is free. So you could have a lot of virtual memory to scan even with little memory. So what we did was implement RMAP. And so the kernel community implemented the RMAP data structure. And since RMAP data structure, what it provides is a reverse lookup. The page table provides you the virtual to physical lookup, and the RMAP provides you the physical to virtual lookup, which means from any given page, so these pages in the previous slide making up the RMAP array in the LRU, from any one of these pages, we can reach all the page table which are mapping them with low computational complexity. So we can very efficiently get this back arrow. And from the back arrow, once we have it, and suppose we want to free this page, which is the blue one, we need to get rid of these two arrows, which are the page table which are mapping it. With the back arrow, we just set the page table null, or swap entry, or whatever, just not present. And then we can effectively free the page. So this RMAP allowed to solve this problem, and the implementation is different depending on the kind of memory we are dealing with. So each kind of memory, so if it's anonymous, if it's a file system cache, if it's a KSM page, they all have different implementation. So the anonymous memory is using a data structure called a non-VMA, which in turn points to the VMA. I'm not sure if you remember I mentioned before what the VMA is. The VMA represents a range of memory which was allocated during MMAP. And once we have the VMA, its immediate release is the page table. So effectively, what we care about is to find the VMA, not even the page table, that the page is mapped into. And if it's a file system page, we get to the inode instead. And the inode is effectively the file. Inode and file is a very similar concept. And from the inode, we get to the prior tree. The prior tree is a very efficient data structure, which in order of log n, so with logarithmical complexity, computational complexity, can search a range in a tree. So it's like an AVL tree, but it's not looked up by just one index. It's looked up by a range, so by a start and an end. Because these VMAs in the mapping of this inode can have an overlap. So you can find many of these which overlap this search. So it's extremely efficient lookup. And then we can have KSM pages. KSM pages are pages created as shared memory. And this actually is the implementation which is the least efficient, because you need one of these RMAP items to track each one of these VMA. If you notice, for file system and anonymous memory, a single object can give you all the VMAs, while for the KSM, each VMA needs a different, a different tracking RMAP item. So it has more memory footprint. And this would be the final and closest to the current state of the virtual memory subsystem and how we are doing reclaim in Linux today. So what we have of difference, of course, compared to the previous slide, is just the introduction of RMAP. As you can see, the scanning over the page table is completely disappeared. And now, when we want, for example, to free page one, we immediately set this page table as null, and then we can immediately free the page. Then there are more complexities when dealing with the reference bits, but you know, this is really the core design and the thing which is more interesting, I think. So this was the previous slide was this one is 2.6, and so this was the state in the current 2.6. And if I were to design 4.5, it wouldn't fit in the picture anymore. So I cannot. So the problem is we got many more LRUs today. So things got more complicated because we got memory C groups. So we have kind of an LRU for each one of these C groups. Then we also have a different LRU for anonymous and the file backed mappings. We are doing more clever things, like if you have memory which is memory locked with mlock, We don't even add these pages to the other use because we know we cannot free them until somebody is doing M-unlock. Same thing if it's anonymous memory and you don't have swap. If it's anonymous memory allocated with M-unlock, the only place you can actually page it out is swap. If you don't add swap to the system, there's no point to waste time scanning with LRU any page. So we are very efficient these days in VM in optimizing even for these details. Another optimization as a side effect of introducing transparent huge pages is the fact a transparent huge page is 500 times bigger than a page. So if you use transparent huge pages, the LRU size decreases by 512 times. And that means it's much faster too. So now we can switch to something more recent. I think this was the full overview of all the milestones of the development in the kernel. But if you check what's going on today, you can see we are optimizing workloads for you. So in the past, we just tried to make the kernel better. Now we are trying to optimizing the hardware so that your application is optimal on the hardware, even though you don't have to do manual tunings on it. One thing, for example, with regard to NUMA is we had the NUMA hard bindings for a long time, and you can actually bind the application in NUMA systems and optimize for NUMA yourself. But these days, we also have automatic and NUMA balancing, for example, with RHEL 7. And then there was huge CLBFS. You could tune your database or your Java virtual machine to use huge CLBFS manually, but not many people are actually doing that. Perhaps with the database, yes, but definitely not for the Java virtual machine. And we got transparent huge pages, which provided the same feature without you having to tune things by hand. And then we also had KSM, which allowed to merge equal memory in different processes. This was also used, for example, in the LAC computation at CERN, not only for virtual machines. So, of course, you can change your program to not to create equal memory. But if the kernel can actually deduplicate the memory for you, so there's no need. So you can actually leverage these features. And thanks, for example, one very recent feature, which is not upstream yet, but I know the developer is pushing for upstream merging soon, and it consists in transparently moving data from the main memory to the GPU graphics memory, for example, with OpenCL, to do computation in graphics memory without actually the application having to tune anything. The kernel will page fault, get the memory from the GPU, put it in the main memory, and the application wouldn't even notice. So again, I think these are interesting trends in the VM of trying to automate all these things. Of course, the optimization can be optionally disabled. So if you want to do a hard tuning by hand, for example, use hard binding with NUMA, sometime it cannot be faster than that. I mean, so there's no way the kernel might be faster than a perfect tuning with hard pinnings, but if you do the hard pinnings, you lose the flexibility. So it's up to you as an administrator if you want to use the cleverness of the VM, which does the things for you, or if you want to optimize things by hand. In some cases, the VM, I think, can do better. But these are the complex cases, like workload, which don't fit as a single NUMA node. But we'll see this later. So I want to add the parenthesis here for opening a question. And it sounds like we have pretty nice features in the VM, especially the latest one are pretty advanced. The core design of the VM is really well done. We have RMAP for all kinds of memories, and things are really going well. So why should we reinvent anything in the virtual memory for virtual machines, like in hypervisors? So why should anybody reinvent anything? I mean, it's not good. And in fact, we don't, because we use KVM. With KVM, we leverage entirely the virtual memory subsystem of the kernel. KVM doesn't have any logic to manage swapping, to manage NUM optimization. all of it is done by the host, by the Linux kernel in the host. And we leverage all this feature when you run virtual machine on top of the KVM hypervisor. So the KVM hypervisor just provides a layer of shadow page tables which create guest mode. Normally you have the user land mode and the kernel mode. That's the normal mode of Linux. But the KVM driver adds just a guest mode with shadow page tables. But from the point of view of the scheduler in the host, from the virtual memory subsystem in the host, the KVM process, QEMU KVM process, is normal process. Doesn't have anything special. So the algorithm which decides which page to swap in a virtual machine is the same algorithm which decides which page to swap in a normal process. So all the optimization I talked about apply 100% to KVM. So when we optimize the host kernel, we are also making the virtual machine faster. So I think that's really a nice property of this design implemented by KVM. And so talking about these topics, like starting with NUMA. NUMA means a not uniform memory architecture. And not uniform memory architecture effectively means we have nodes. We have different NUMA nodes in a server. So the memory is not the same for all the nodes. And each node by itself will have some memory, some CPU, it can have PCI devices. And all the nodes are interconnected. And unfortunately, the interconnects are slow. So not so slow, some new NUMA are pretty fast, but still are slower than working within the node. So one question, if anybody is willing to answer, why NUMA? So why would we want to complicate our lives? Perhaps even cell phones will become NUMA one day, we don't know. Why NUMA? Okay, I can answer. And it's not obvious, but once I will tell the answer, I hope it's intuitive. And the bandwidth given by the RAM is limited. And you may have noticed that we have always more cores in each socket. So when you plug a socket in a computer, you get 10 cores with 10 hyperthreads, which become 20 hyperthreads total, so two hyperthreads for each core. And so there's only so much a single memory channel can give you in memory bandwidth. So it's not worth anymore to keep adding CPUs and CPUs and CPUs, because then it becomes a diminishing return. So what we have to do is to add more memory channels and give a memory channel to each socket. So the problem, of course, is if you have so many CPUs and all the CPUs compute in a single memory channel because you're only using the memory of one node, you're running at half the bandwidth of what you could get if you were using all the memory bandwidth of both channels. And again, these days, any two-socket system is a NUMA system, practically. So SUSE is pretty relevant if you are managing any server. And so I'm going to describe you what the default NUMA policy does in Linux until at least RHEL 6. And it's called an MPOL default. The logic of MPOL default is to allocate memory from the local node of the current CPU, if it's available, so if it's not full. So if there's some memory free, we allocate it from the local node. And that's pretty okay if this is a short-lived task. And we'll see it in the next slide why. So let's suppose we have a KVM virtual machine running in node zero. This is a very basic example. There is only one CPU per node and one memory per node. So if you have KVM running in CPU 0, and KVM is not doing short-lived allocation, when KVM allocates memory, it's going to keep running potentially for days or months. A virtual machine doesn't need to be necessarily shut down immediately. So this is an example of the worst case, of course, for the MPOL default, so it's for the default memory policy. So when KVM does allocation, the allocation will go to the local node. And that's good, because we are going to get CPU and memory within the same node, and the access is fast. So what happens if we start the kernel build or some other jittering in the scheduler because you start, I don't know, benchmark or something, you can do that. And the CPU scheduler might decide to schedule a make command in the CPU 0. And perhaps KVM gets migrated to CPU 1. Over time, if you wait long enough, this will happen. And what happens then? Well, with just the mempool default, right, like in the RHEL 6 kernels, the KVM could stay there in CPU 1 forever. So there was no way the scheduler would notice that the memory of this process, of this KVM process, was allocated in the node 0, and he had to put back the KVM process to node 0 in CPU 0 once it became idle. There was not enough intelligence in the memory management and in the scheduler to figure out that this was not the best way to run the KVM process. And so I think I explained what was the problem of mempool default. And pretty much what automatic NUMA balancing is doing is to solve this problem. And before going into that, I'm going to show you how you can solve this problem manually, and you can do it as an administrator easily, at least as long as you are okay to lose a little bit of flexibility with NUMA control. So there's another task called NUMA stats to check the status of the NUMA layout of all the processes in the system. Or, as a programmer, you can use the syscalls, mempolicy, mbind, sked set affinity, move pages, or CPU sets. They are all kernel APIs, so you can do the NUMA optimization by hand. As you can imagine, this is not trivial, and you, again, I said it before, you lose flexibility, a lot of flexibility, because once you pin the application to run in a certain node, if the load goes away from another node, there's no way it's going to move there. So it's inflexible. One last thing I want to mention is NUMA-D. And NUMA-D can actually optimize things for you. It's like a manager in user land, which monitors all the statistics from the kernel, and it tries to move application from one node to the next. But it tends to do it all at once. So it's not in doing things in a fine-grained way. It's an automatic manual pinning, kind of. And libvirt is also an API. So you, if you use libvirt to start virtual machines, you can do the same pinnings of the left side of the slide through XML protocol in libvirt, XML format in libvirt. The critical memory policies which are in the kernel are the default, of course, which I already mentioned, and then there are other four. And they translate to commands, which if you do man NUMA control, you will find the right side of the slide in the documentation. So you will see dash dash preferred equal node, or dash dash interleaved equal node, or dash dash local alloc. These commands in NUMA control translate to the left side of the slide, which is the kernel actual implementation of these features. And preferred actually means choose not necessarily the CPU where the process is running on, but any other node. But if it's full, you can spill into the other nodes. Bind instead means only that node. Interleaved is probably the most interesting to use manually. Interleave means this application is going to seek all over the memory. So there's not going to be locality, and you cannot just put it in a single node. And if you need to span all over the nodes, interleave means put the memory in each node interleaved. And that means trying to use all the bandwidth of all the memory channels you have in all the nodes. Because you're not going to be running for long in any one of these nodes, statistically speaking. You're going to seek a little bit all over the nodes, and so you get better utilizations. So if you want to optimize for a database which has a huge amount of memory interleaved, could be the right choice. Again, we are talking about manual tunings. From a practical standpoint, if you were to run a couple of virtual machines without any NUMA tunings, you would see this kind of output from NUMA stat, where you can see the memory of these four virtual machines end up in each one of the seven nodes. So, there's no affinity. And if instead you were going to run these with the manual pinnings, you could easily set up, for example, the last KVM process to be running on node 2 only. And as you can see, the other two are also running in their own node. So each one of these is using 8 GB of memory. And they completely run within the node. And that's actually the best way to run virtual machine if they can fit in a single node. Each virtual machine in its own node. So the innovation here was to try to do all of these without NUMA hard binding. So without the administrator having to touch anything. The kernel should be able to optimize these workloads by itself. No matter if it's a virtual machine, if it's a process, if it's a database, it just needs to be optimal. And the way we solved this problem was to implement two kind of logics which works together. One, I call it CPU follow memory. The other is memory follow CPU. So we introduced the gravity between CPU and memory. Memory attracts CPU very aggressively. CPU attracts memory not so aggressively, so very, you know, very conservative way. And the reason is a CPU switch from one node to another node. It's not very expensive. You can switch CPU and you only lose the CPU cache, but you can refresh it by reading back from memory. It's like a couple of megabytes of CPU cache. It's not huge. It's not a huge loss. While moving the memory itself from one node to the next is very expensive. So we have to be very conservative about that. Moving the memory requires copying the memory across the interconnects. It requires sending APIs to invalidate the old location of the page table to point to the new location of the memory. And so it's really an expensive thing which needs to be done conservatively. And if we do these two algorithms together, we see we can optimize things. Of course, I'm kind of simplifying here. I'm not going into too many details, but I'm trying to show what's happening when you run this algorithm in some basic workload. So suppose you have four CPUs, two CPU per node, and you have two nodes. And you also have four threads and two processes. So you can see the red is one process, and the blue is another process. And the two threads in blue are using memory from RAM 0, and the two threads in red are also using memory from RAM 0. And as I told before, this will not be optimal because you will be using only one memory channel. So you will be effectively computing at half the speed of what you can get if you run automatic NUMA balancing, because automatic NUMA balancing will immediately see, I mean, this is totally trivial workload for automatic NUMA balancing. There's no way it would keep running in the bad way. Very quickly, it would converge in the setup I just shown, which is to copy the memory into RAM 1, and then the processes are also converged in their own nodes. So it converges both the memory and the threads in the right node. And this runs almost double the speed. Same thing you can do if you only have threads. And this is actually a more complex scenario. It's much more difficult to optimize these with hard bindings. In fact, it's not even possible with the NUMA control wrapper, because the NUMA control wrapper is made against the process. And if you only have one process, there's no way you can tell which part of the memory should go in a node or in the other node. You can do it with a sysbind, with a syscall, but the programmer needs to do that. The system administrator would have much bigger trouble to optimize for this one. And again, this is 100% optimized by automatic NUMA balancing, as long as each thread, or at least each set of two threads, are using their own local thread storage. So if each one is computing its own memory, like, I don't know, an MPI computation, which is, you know, splitting the problem in many parts, and each thread computes on its own, then it will immediately converge, because it will notice each thread is using certain part of the memory, and it will migrate that memory to the other node. So that sounds really nice, because, again, It's not so easy to do even by manual tuning. And SUSE is 100% guaranteed to converge. I'm going to show a benchmark of this automatic NUMA balancing, showing you the difference between no tuning at all, so like RHEL 6, and automatic NUMA balancing, or hard pinnings, so NUMA hard pinnings. And this is running OLTP workloads, so a database, at different user count. And we are going to show the transaction per minutes, and of course, the higher the better. So as you can see, for a low number of users, when the system is not entirely CPU bound yet, and SUSE, by the way, is running in a virtual machine, and there are four virtual machines. So with the low user count, when the system is not 100% CPU bound yet, the cost of the algorithm itself is the most insignificant, and the performance of the red, which is automatic NUMA balancing, and the blue, which is the hard pinnings, is about the same. So the performance is the most identical, and it's practically not even worth doing the hard pinnings. If you go to the very high CPU utilization case, of course, the hard pinnings can give you an edge, but you lose in flexibility. If you use automatic NUMA balancing, if the host workload changes, virtual machine quits, it can actually optimize things for you, and you don't even need to care. So you can use our pinnings, but you need to know exactly what you're doing. And if you use it well, you can have an edge against what the kernel does for you. It's automatic NUMA balancing. And so the next thing I want to tell you is how to enable or disable it. So for example, if you have dubs that is not optimizing things for you, because of course it's an heuristic, we do our best to make things which can only improve performance, but because it's an heuristic, there is also a way to disable it and to test it without. So it's very simple. You just have to echo 0 into this slash proc sys kernel NUMA balancing file. And if you want to enable it back, just echo 1, and it will work. There is also a parameter for boot time, but it's not probably that interesting. Just NUMA balancing to pass through the group command line. And in RHEL 7, sys is enabled by default in any NUMA hardware. So this is, again, a new feature of RHEL 7. So if you just check with NUMA controls dash dash hardware, if your hardware is supporting NUMA, it will also tell you that it's enabled by default if you're running a recent RHEL 7 distribution or very recent upstream kernel. The next topic I want to talk is about the development in huge pages. So I'm not sure if you are familiar with what huge pages are, but you might know the x86 architecture gave us traditionally 4 kilobyte pages. So generally the page size is 4 kilobyte. The problem is we are not having any more 128 megabytes of memory like 20 years ago. We are having 128 gigabytes or terabytes of memory to manage, and 4K start to get a little small when you start to deal with that kind of memory. Because the smaller the pages, the more overhead you have to manage them. And what if you had bigger pages, like 512 times bigger? That would be 2 megabytes, of course. Well, that's all what transparent huge pages is about, and also usually BFS before it. And the whole point here is to drop an entire layer of page tables at the bottom. This was the previous slide, and that applied 4K pages. With huge pages, you will drop the last layer. And incidentally, this 512 number that is exactly the multiple of 4K, which gives you 2 megabytes, is completely derived from this picture. So the 48 bits of maximal address space you can address on the x86-64, the 2 megabyte page size, which is exactly 512 times 4K, is given by this picture. As I told you before, there should be 512 arrows here, of course, but it wouldn't fit. So all these things are interconnected in some way. So what's the benefit of huge pages? Well, it's all about improving performance. There is also a little bit of memory benefit in having less page tables, but that's not really the interesting part. In fact, there are some cons too, like when you actually take a page fault, and it's a 2 megabyte page fault. Before you can show the memory to the user land, you have to clear 2 megabytes. previously you would just need to clear 4K. So there are very few cons, but there are a few. And there might be also a little higher memory footprint, because, for example, if you touch 1 byte, you get 2 megabytes in the page fault. So you touch 1 byte in a piece of memory you're located, and you actually only intend to use that 1 byte, you're actually paying for 2 megabytes physically. If you were not using huge pages, you would only pay for 4 kilobytes. So, but of course, the application should not map 2 megabytes if it intends to only use 1 byte. So if the application intends to use 1 byte, it should allocate 1 byte or 4K at most if it kind of knows how the architecture works, and there's no way to allocate less than 4K. So this still is critical to have huge pages, because without huge pages, especially the virtual machines with nested page table, gets extremely slow. And the reason is shown by this picture, because we have the TLB miss cost for virtual machines is very different if you have THP non and the transparent huge pages, or even huge TLBFS. That's no difference in this case for the cost. Between THP off and THP on. So you have very big difference here. For the bare metal, it's not so different. This would be without virtualization. And so for virtual machines, huge pages and transparent huge pages are completely essential. So before THP, we had huge TLBFS, but again, it's a not flexible version of it. So it doesn't allow you to swap out. The memory needs to be reserved at boot. So at the boot command line in grab, you need to reserve the memory. That's very inflexible, because it kind of breaks the design choice that all the free memory should be usable as cache. If you reserve the memory inside UTLBFS, you lose it as free memory. So you cannot use it as cache. And there's no fallback either. So if you run out of this reservation, you can get an out-of-memory condition, even though there's still plenty of memory free, but perhaps it's not defragmented. And in turn, you cannot find a 2 megabyte physically contiguous piece, despite you may have several gigabytes free. And it also requires an admin privilege. So unless, of course, the distribution is not mounting the file system for you and giving you the default permission to use it, to mount UTLBFS, and because it requires a mount, you need some privilege. So it's not running without privilege. Effectively, only databases, and of course, also the real-time people is using UTLBFS. And UTLBFS, because it's like a hard allocation, and it's guaranteed allocation, it can actually help in real-time, because you have kind of very different requirements from regular application. Real time, for example, doesn't want swapping, for example. So it's a very different world. So with transparent huge pages, we aim to do everything UTLBFS can do, but without having to configure anything. So the idea is that any process will receive 2 megabytes, so huge pages, if the map region, so if the malloc, malloc, or mmap, or POSIX memaline, is at least 2 megabytes naturally aligned. So if it's large, 2 megabytes and naturally aligned, you will get a huge page. This is only possible, of course, if compaction, which is the algorithm in the kernel, which is supposed to produce the huge pages, is capable of producing them. It's not guaranteed, but the whole point is that the entire thing is transparent to user land. And transparent huge pages can be enabled with slash syskernel mm transparent huge pages enabled. And this flag can be set to always mAdvisor never. So there's a lot of talk these days because there are a few kind of corner cases like, this database, a cache called Redis, and this is not very efficient with transparent pages. We still have how to optimize for that. There are a few other cases which have not shown the top performance. But at the same time, if you're dealing with other kind of workloads, virtual machines are the quintessential example. They absolutely require THP. I mean, if you don't run virtual machines with THP, even databases inside virtual machines. It's just not pure computation, even I/O. They are extremely slow, so it's absolutely essential to have transparent huge pages enabled for certain workloads. And back to the problem of why THP might not be always an optimization, I'm going to show what is the relation between memory compaction and transparent huge pages. So we have memory compaction, which is the producer. And if you do a long live allocation, spending some time defragmenting the memory, it's not a significant amount of cost. But if you're doing a lot of allocations and at high frequency, so you keep allocating and freeing the memory and use it for a very short period, you're going to pay for memory compaction over and over again. And this cost will keep accumulating. And the little speed up you get for the little computation you're doing, thanks to transparent huge pages on the right, is not enough to offset the cost of the compaction you did. So effectively, if you have long-lived allocation like a virtual machine, absolutely you want to pay for the compaction and have transparent huge pages allocated immediately. Otherwise, it's kind of more a gray area. I mean, it's not guaranteed that it's always an optimization to have THP on. So lately, we are discussing upstream in the Linux kernel mailing list how to tune better for these cases. And it looks like we are going to change to a defer mode or M-advise mode in this other setting, which is SUSE kernel MM transparent huge page defrag. So a lot of the people which might actually have found a workload and recommends you to disable THP, I'm going to say it's wrong. They should disable the frag, not THP, because the cost, the thing which hurts, is actually the defragmentation of the memory with compaction. And it only hurts if the location is short-lived. So when people ask to change default, like, for example, if you're going to likely change the defrag default from always to defer or M-advise, I'm afraid soon there will be somebody complaining, oops, from this kernel, this application is running slower. And the good thing, however, is we can optimize it. And we can optimize it with a MADV huge page. OK, I wrote it here. So it was the next slide, but it's here. We can keep using direct compaction if the application uses this M-advise. So there is an M-advise that the application can use. And in fact, QEMU and KVM is already using for years. That will still call compaction because SUSE M-advise is telling the kernel, SUSE allocation is long-lived. I want transparent huge pages here immediately. So if your application is doing computations in anonymous memory, you should use M-advise huge page if the allocation is long-lived. Long-lived just means you allocate the memory once and you compute for 1 hour, for example. Okay? So if you're allocating the memory, computing for 1 millisecond and freeing it, well, no, you shouldn't use this M-advise. So back to the other problem of application like Redis. Redis is doing something pretty peculiar, which is to use fork to do a snapshot. So the parent process keeps writing and writing while the child process is reading and writing to disk. And of course, after fork, all the memory is read-only. So the parent, while it writes, is going to do copy and writes. And of course, doing copy and writes of only 4K is going to be faster. We are going to allocate less memory in the parent. We are going to copy less memory from the child to the parent. And so in this case, Redis should just use MADV, no huge page. So there's absolutely a way to optimize for this, which is to disable transparent huge pages. Luckily, in the next part of the presentation, I'm going to show yet another feature, which is userfaultfd write tracking, which might allow Redis not to use fork to do the snapshotting and not even need to disable transparent huge pages to be optimal. So during the snapshot process, it would use userfaultfd, but when it's actually computing, even Redis will be faster with transparent huge pages. It just does this corner case during the snapshotting, which is basically making him lose a lot of the benefits of transparent huge pages, which got benefit from before the snapshot. So I hope I cleared a little bit of the questions I get also on mailing list about how to optimize for THP, because this is a pretty common discussion. And so the latest development in THP space, transparent THP space, is the new ref counting design, which was merged in 4.5. It's quite a large change in the ref counting, and it's very well done. So I'm very happy about that. And the whole point of this change is that it opens the door to move transparent huge pages in more places. Right now, transparent huge pages is restricted to anonymous memory. So there's a lot of memory in the system. If you check the stats in /proc, that is allocated as anonymous memory in any system. But there is also a lot of memory, for example, in shared memory. And the THP so far couldn't move in shared memory, because shared memory effectively looks like a file system. It's file backed memory. It's kind of more complex to deal with. So it's not incidental that transparent huge pages started with anonymous memory and not with file backed memory. So with THP ref counting design in 4.5, we can hope to move THP and TMPFS. And this will reduce the scope of UTLBS further, because UTLBFS was with shared memory, which THP was not. Use shared memory if you fork and you have a child process which is sharing the memory with the parent. But if you just want writable shared memory both ways, that was not available in THP so far. And there are currently two implementations, and they are quite different. One is component-based, very similar to how the anonymous pages works, and one instead is based on small page sizes. So basically, you keep using small page structures, but you still keep track of them and you make them together. You make sure they are like physically contiguous, and then you create a huge page mapping on top of those. And the last year at the LSF Mem Summit, so it's the Linux Origin File System and Memory Management Summit, there was a lot of time dedicated to these developments. And some of it, of course, has been merged, like I said, it's a ref counting design. But this year, next month, there will be the next LSFM Summit 2016. And probably, I expect, we are going to talk not a long time about this THP and TMPFS. So there are a lot of exciting developments in THP these days. The next topic will be QEMU and KVM live migration. So the last thing I've been working on was exactly this space. And the state of the art was pre-copy. So pre-copy live migration effectively means when you want to migrate a virtual machine from one node to another node in your cloud, private cloud, public cloud, doesn't matter. Just two different computers. And when you do the live migration, you keep sending all the guest memory in a loop. And you track the dirty pages which are left to send. So while you're sending, the guest keeps running in the source node. And while it's running, it's making more memory dirty, so it modifies it again. So effectively, after you finish sending, you still have found more stuff to send because it became dirty while you were sending it. And so in short, this algorithm doesn't work. It doesn't work because if you have enough memory in the guest, like, I don't know, 128 gigabytes. I don't even mean terabytes, okay? But yeah, obviously with terabytes, but even with small amount of memory, as long as you have a little bit of activity in the guest, it's not completely idle, you're still going to dirty memory faster than what you can send through the network, even if you have a very fast network, because the memory bus is still too fast compared to any other piece of the computer. And so this really doesn't converge in all cases. So it's not reliable. That's the point. So if you want to really flush away the virtual machine as fast as you can, you cannot with pre-copy. So what we've been working on is this concept of memory externalization. And we see later how we call it in terms of live migration. But the memory externalization effectively is the idea of having a compute node and a memory node. And the idea is to have a computation running in a node, so a computer, despite the memory actually is in another node. And while you're computing, if you access memory which is missing, Celsius mechanism called user fault, which will bring you the memory. And if, for example, you start being low on memory on the compute node, you could theoretically push the memory back to the memory node. So that's the basic idea of what memory externalization is about. So we didn't imply to implement all of it immediately. I'm not even sure if all of it is a good idea, actually. But certainly, one way, so the way where we put the memory from the remote node to the compute node is has a huge potential because it allows to implement postcopy live migration. And in postcopy live migration terms, the remote node will be the source QEMU, so the source virtual machine, the original node where the virtual machine was running on. And the compute node would be the QEMU destination. So the idea is that you start the virtual machine immediately in the destination node, while some of the memory, or potentially all of it, is still in the source node. This way, for example, worst case, you transfer all the memory once. There's no way you can keep sending and sending and sending and you never converge. Secondly, you can predict how much time it will take to do a live migration, even if you are live migrating a 1 terabyte guest, because you just have to divide the total maximum RAM that you have to send by the bandwidth of the network. So the way we implemented this is, because the implementation of this one was not exactly trivial, you could do this, for example, with a huge change in the kernel, where the kernel actually speaks the network protocol, but we didn't want to do that. So the idea here was to provide an abstraction so that QEMU could actually get notified whenever the guest mode, not even the normal user land mode, but even the guest mode, both, even the user land mode, but whenever anything would try to access memory, which was still in the source node, QEMU had to be notified. And then QEMU, with its own normal migration protocol, would speak to the source node and ask for the memory. This way, QEMU can still do this kind of live migrations through an SSH tunnel or any kind of other protocol. So it's not in the kernel, the actual network protocol. It's completely up to QEMU, how we transfer the memory. QEMU is just being told by the kernel that if anything computes in a piece of memory, this will be pages, and the green ones will be actually already in the destination. The transparent ones, the blue ones, would be missing. So whenever the guest or QEMU itself is sitting in one of these, a QEMU thread, called the migration thread, the user fault FD migration thread, is notified. And it gets, it's getting the address of the fault. And then QEMU will use another IO control of the user fault FD to move the received memory. So initially it receives the memory in a temporary address. But with this IO control, UFFD or copy, it will move the memory atomically into the guest. It's critical to do an atomic move, an atomic copy, because if it wouldn't be atomic, it could see partial data. So we needed to introduce this atomic copy called a user fault FD IO copy to provide and show the memory to the guest in an atomic way. Of course, when we introduce a new abstraction in the kernel, which potentially had one use, quickly, if it's done well, it finds other uses. And for example, there was interest recently also from user fault FD write protection for postcopy live snapshotting. So currently, we are tracking the missing pages. But you could also track write protected faults, not only not present faults. And so we're going to extend it to do that. And perhaps Redis can, in fact, use stat to do snapshotting without using fork. It can do it with a thread, a user fault thread, which I think would be more efficient too. And then we can have the user fault used for container live migration, which means a kernel-less live migration, so just migration of the container user land. And recently, even CRIU, checkpoint restore in user land, had interest in user fault FD to be able to do a restore despite the memory was not completely read from disk yet. So you start, you do the restore, despite you didn't finish reading all the state you saved on disk. And the user fault latency in a benchmark can be seen, and it's probably the most interesting variable, because if it's too high, it will not be good. And as you can see from this benchmark, we are talking about in a 10 gigabit Ethernet with the very recent RL7.2 plus and QEMU.5 kernel and the user LAN, that the average latency is about 17 milliseconds, which is the same order of magnitude of the swapping seeking on a disk. And of course, this was done also with this optimization, which allows to do read around. So when the source node is asked to send memory, it will send all the memory which is around the place of the fault, so it becomes already available. So when a user fault triggers in the destination node, a lot of times, the source node already sent the data which was going to be asked next. So checking a full workload using postcopy live migration compared to pre-copy live migration, we see that pre-copy live migration gets a new sheet here. Effectively, this gets main hit by not being able to use THP during postcopy. But the point of this slide is not so much the performance, the fact it cannot complete the live migration until the workload completes. As you can see here, the performance is going down because the benchmark is finished. And effectively, the live migration didn't succeed. With the postcopy live migration instead, we get the, by the way, we are running pre-copy, a pass of pre-copy before starting post-copy. So it's always a good idea to give a try to pre-copy first, but not spend much time on that. I mean, we ran a pass of it for 2 minutes, which is about the time it takes to transfer these, in the previous slide, I wrote it was 120 gigabyte guest on a 10 gigabit NIC. So it takes about 120 seconds to transfer this memory through the network. So we ran a pass of 2 minutes of pre-copy, which is decreasing performance, but only in half, actually less than half, because it was from 800,000 to 500,000. And then when pre-copy is finished in its pass, we start post-copy. And there is an initial hit, but then a very quick ramp up, and the performance returns optimal. So there are two ways to use post-copy live migration. And from the libvirt command line, virsh, so it's going to be postcopy after, which means start postcopy after trying precopy 120 seconds in this case, or simply postcopy after precopy, which I think is more optimal. So you always run a full pass of precopy, and if it didn't converge, you start postcopy immediately. So the last, very last topic today is going to be KSM. I'm going to be very quick on this one because you think I'm really late. And so the KSM memory duplication is all about doing what you can find also in some file system. You can have some file system which are deduplicating data for you. So even the Git itself is deduplicating data. And the idea is similar, but for memory. So we are going to take two pieces of memory which have the same content. In this example, it would be all H characters. And they are both writable. And you have two mappings on it, one from a shadow page table and one from a regular page table. And the same thing is for the other one, but they take the double amount of space in memory. So it's going to be 4 kilobytes and 4 kilobytes. And the idea here is to create a single page of write protected, of course, of only 4 kilobytes. So you can free the other 4 kilobytes. So once this is running, this is effectively freeing the memory. You fire up KSMD and you see the free memory in the free command going up. And you can see it going up at a rate of, I don't know, 100 megabytes per second. Depends, of course, how much CPU you dedicate to the task. And the API is very simple. It's just some advice, mergeable and unmergeable. And there's also a /syskernel-mm-ksm directory where you can find all the tunings. But generally, you will not use this by hand. You would use ksm-tuned, which is daemon, which is also enabled by default, for example, in Rev, and /atc-ksm-tuned allows you to configure this daemon. But the idea is just to start the KSM only when you're low on memory. So you could start KSM even when you have plenty of memory free, and it would deduplicate memory. But until you are actually low on memory, there's not much point to spend CPU doing that. And again, like I said before, it's not only for KVM. It's primarily for KVM. But for example, even Cyanogen mode supports KSM. So if you want to save memory on the cell phone, you can run KSM on the cell phone if you use Cyanogen mode. So the last innovation in this space was KSM scale. So I'm not sure if you remember this slide I showed in the RMAP implementation here. If I can go back, yes, I could. So this was a list. And we had one entry in this list for each VMA. So what's the problem? The problem is we have been running KSM in very large systems with 100 gigabytes of memory. And the duplication possible was massive, which means it saved massive amounts of memory. But it also means this list became too long. It potentially had millions of entries in a terabyte machine. So walking a list of a terabyte of entries, if you just wanted to move the KSM page from one place to the next to do memory compaction, or you wanted to do a migration because NUMA asked for migration or anything, that would have been too expensive. And in fact, this long list could create stalls up to, you know, dozens of seconds. That's not good. So the last change in the KSM algorithm has been all about optimizing this scalability problem by introducing a limit for the sharing. So now there is a sys control you can set, which by default is set to 256, which limits the size of that list in the RMAP code to 256 entries. And this way you can start KSM, even a 1 terabyte system or more, at full CPU usage, so there's no way it can interfere with the workload. And that's very important because otherwise, you know, it will be like not so reliable if you had a lot of memory. So this is really the kind of problems you run into when you have an algorithm and you start running it on a bigger and bigger system. The good thing is limiting effectively the compression ratio that KSM can provide to 256 instead of being infinite compression ratio is not so bad because the more you increase it, the more you're hitting diminishing returns. So 256 as a compression ratio is not bad at all, I think. So the summary, and that's the last slide, is I think it's amazing to see the room there was for further innovation since 99. I mean, when I started, I couldn't realize it, but there was still huge room for innovation, and I think there is still. So the other thing I noticed is that things constantly looks pretty mature. And they might actually have been, considering back then the system was so small with only, you know, a couple of hundred megabytes of memory. So this algorithm I showed initially with the clock algorithms, which were extremely simple, might actually been okay for those. But these days, with this large hardware we have, complex hardware we have, I think it's unthinkable to maintain the current level of mission critical complexity by reinventing the wheel in a not open source way. So perhaps it can still be managed if you limit your hardware to a few set of laptop of cell phone models. But if you deal with the whole world of the hardware out there, from a cell phone to a supercomputer, the open source way and the Linux way, I think, is a winning solution. And I also believe all this innovation I've shown and the evolution of the VM had over the last 17, 20 years, even before I was involved, is one of the reasons, of the plenty of other reasons, of course, that contributed to the Linux success and also the KVM lead, because as I said before, KVM is the only hypervisor, if compared to all its predecessors, which can leverage the full feature set of the virtual memory subsystem of Linux. So that's all. And if you have questions, I'm available.
We have a Q&A session now. Please line up with the microphones, and I'll call people there. We'll have a trivia session after this. So please go ahead.
There's been a lot of work recently to merge power-saving code into both the scheduler and the virtual memory system. A lot of that had to do with small machines and compacting processes onto smaller numbers of CPU sets and smaller numbers of cores. How does it interact with things like NUMA controls auto-tuning? Because it seems like they have exactly opposite goals in a lot of ways.
So I'm not sure if there's much collision between NUMA, because generally when you care so much about the power consumption, luckily the cell phones are not NUMA yet. So. But yes, there's certainly a lot of interaction, and I think the main reason, the main problem actually in the power saving has been the fact that Android kept a little bit of different API compared to the upstream API in the way you do power management. So I think that's the most controversial. But for the other part, I think everything has been pretty straightforward and don't see many problems in that area.
So even the auto-tuning scheduling that's attempting to, you know, compact processing into smaller and smaller parts of the board, that can play well with auto-tuning?
That's a scheduling question. I think it should be, I mean, I remember the SUSE control which can enable this feature. I don't know how much they are effective. So I think, the main critical part of power saving, I think, applies more to really small devices. And unfortunately, they tend to use kernel, which have some modification compared to the stream kernels, so not always. For example, the governor on Android is interactive, which is not normally the one you would use upstream. So there are some differences, but I think they both work very well. We just need to try to converge them all in the same upstream kernel, I think.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Hey, good talk.
Thank you.
Question. So on the transparent huge pages, you mentioned briefly that to a developer accessing that, you would normally want to do something like allocate memory in 2 megabyte page sizes, and then if it was possible, you would get a huge page allocated that way. Exactly. Can you talk any more specifically about how developers would access that feature, both at a low level and if there's people that are working at a higher level with, say, like interpreted languages?
Okay, that's a good question. So the Java Virtual Machine is fully optimized for that. So because, again, like you recorded exactly what I said from the slide, if you do a POSIX memoline, so it gives you a naturally aligned piece of memory, a multiple of 2 megabytes, you're going to get transparent huge pages if it's anonymous memory. So the optimal way to use it would be POSIX memaline with an alignment of 2 megabytes. If you're using an high-level language like Java, that's 100% optimized. Unfortunately, I cannot say the same thing for Python. However, Python is not very high performance. So it's I love Python, so that's, I'm fine, but my point is, if you need top performance, you might want to use a language which optimizes for that. I think it's possible to optimize it in Python. I actually did tricks, change environment variables, which can tune glibc, to do larger allocations in bigger chunks by default, and that gives you huge pages even with Python, but it's not the default. So generally, yes, I don't have a full answer for this one, because each language will change a little bit, and each one has its own runtime, or each one has its own libraries which manage the memory. So if you're using C language, you should optimize it yourself, and that's a very good idea. For example, GCC can do that. But if you're in a high-level language, well, you should stick to the ones which optimize for it. And again, the Java machine optimized for C specific huge pages problem even before transparent huge pages existed. So by the time we implemented transparent huge pages, there was no change required, just working.
Okay, great. You mentioned 3-4 languages there, C++, C, and everything. Do you know the status on any of the other languages before I go check myself, like V8, the JavaScript V8 interpreter, or any Ruby or anything else off the top of your head? Do you know if they're using
I told you the one I'm sure about, and I think we can talk about this later. I mean, this is, there are too many languages to cover them all, I think.
Question for you on, actually two questions. One is, with 3D crosspoint technology, the kind of somewhat durable potential memory coming about, is there any thoughts on how one might, for things like Zookeeper or other synchronous state stores where you've got a log that you need to write, and that's usually one of your limitations, databases, et cetera, how one might try to do maybe the memory externalization you were talking about to be able to say, hey, you know, I want to rehydrate myself after a crash or something, And similarly, I don't want to use file system in the VFS layer. I want to just be able to write to memory and assume that that's going to be durable for me. I don't know if that's something that's crossed your radar, maybe you've given much thought about, but it's something that I've kind of wondered about. The other challenge is something like, say, Zookeeper is written in Java and certainly trying to get access. I run a bunch of systems that run Apache Spark, which is an in-memory computation system largely. And one of the things that Java's nice about is it constrains the failure domain of somebody writing bad code. The problem is when you're doing in-memory computation, you don't want to have everyone have their own copy of that memory. I don't tend to see KSM on my machines recognizing that, hey, you know, user Bob and user Joe have both loaded the same data sets in memory. I would like to collapse that down. And there's no way to call POSIX MAdvise from Java to be able to say, hey, that is actually mergeable memory. And
that's a good point. So actually, I have a patch where you can enable KSM all over the memory. So you don't have to call MAdvise. But it's not upstream. So yes, in this case, because it's, again, it's connected to the previous question. Because when we offload all the memory management to the Java virtual machine, to a just-in-time compiler, or anyway, to a language which is completely hiding the pointers from you, it's impossible for you to optimize effectively. It needs to be optimized inside the runtime, inside the just-in-time.
But in this case, it's two different JVMs that are completely unaware, too. It's the fact that as the Hadoop system is administrator, I can look at they're accessing the same blocks on the Hadoop distributed file system. So I know, because it's an append-only file system, that it's guaranteeably the same data that they're loading into memory.
So again, because it's just-in-time compiler in between you and the hardware, we need to tackle it at the just-in-time compiler level. So for example, OpenJDK ICT could actually be modified to do that. So my best solution would actually be to tackle it inside ICT and OpenJDK, because as long as we deal with a proprietary, not open source, just-in-time compiler, we are basically stuck in doing tricks like changing the kernel to enable, KSM everywhere, or work around the fact we cannot modify the just-in-time compiler. But once it's open source, we can actually solve the problem. So that's I think is
not to monopolize your time, but it's actually two different processes run by two different users. So I don't know how the JIT would be able to be aware of what's.
That's fine. Okay. KSM can actually duplicate through different users. That's perfectly okay.
Okay, so you would just you would advocate MAdvise from the JIT.
Manageable, and that will work. But you need to modify the Java virtual machine.
Only small things.
All right, I have two questions, actually. Maybe the first one is really easy. So how does the kernel know if the memory is active or inactive? And then the second question is, how does the current VMM implementation compare to like FreeBSD and Solaris and Windows and other operating systems, like from a high level?
Okay, so the first question, when the memory is first allocated as cache, because you did some I/O, you don't know if it's going to be used once or used many. So you add it to the inactive list, always. The inactive list will never be zero in size. There will always be some size of it. And you give a full cycle of the rotation of the LRU inside the inactive list for it to be elevated to active. So whenever you get a cache hit of a page in the inactive list, you know it's not inactive anymore. You know it's not used once. You know it's used many because you just got a hit and you move it to the active list. You literally list del, list add to different lists. That's how it's being elevated at active. That's the short version. In reality, we use reference bits to try to think more optimal, so we don't do many list add, list del operations, but the way it's preserved and the way it gets promoted to active is through lookup, a cache hit. So initially, they are born inactive, and they're getting activated at the first hit. That's the idea. Second question.
Sorry. Come to the mic, please. Otherwise, okay. He's asking how do you demote from active
yes,
to inactive?
The demote was the balancing algorithm between active and inactive. So initially, we try to keep both lists about the same size. What it means is, after you keep shrinking from the inactive list, it will get smaller. And proportionally, compared to the inactive list size, the active list will get bigger because it didn't get shrink. So eventually, we'll start shrinking a little bit of the active list, moving it to the inactive head. So the active tail goes into the inactive head. So effectively, the active becomes smaller and the inactive becomes bigger. The problem is we never had a good solution for how much we had to shrink from the active list at any given time until recently. Now we also have a very good algorithm to actually calculate the optimal size of the active compared to the inactive list. And we do it tracking every fault. So when even after we shrink the cache, we keep track, we add this piece of memory of this inode cache at some point in the past, and we track this information for a long time, at least until the file is closed, deleted, or something. So because we have the default information, we can tell if it was worth keeping a bigger inactive cache or not. So that's not a simple algorithm, but it's already implemented. It got merged in 2014. Any other question? I think.
More questions? Can you ask at the mic?
Gentleman also asked for you to compare Linux VM to FreeBSD, to Solaris, right, to Windows.
So I wish you didn't have this question because I don't have a good answer. So it's very difficult for me to tell exactly what the other operating system, especially the proprietary one, are doing. I never had much exposure to Solaris or Windows. So I can tell about BSD. BSD, I think, they also have something like transparent huge pages, for example. And however, they have different design. And I think, again, I'm not very comfortable to answer this question because we would not want to say anything wrong. But as far as we know, we have a design where our transparent huge pages, how I actually implemented those, is immediately, as soon as we can use the transparent huge page, get the full benefit of it. So get immediately the huge PMD, immediately the huge TLB. So because transparent huge pages have a little of cost to be able to be created, I try to have the maximal benefit from the start. While, as far as you know, the other operating systems are kind of more incremental in how they provide the transparent huge pages. They start smaller and bigger, and then eventually they get to huge pages. But again, I'm not entirely comfortable, so if anybody can correct me, feel free.
Now, it's my own question. I mean, you've described Linux VM as essentially a single monolithic implementation design with a lot of heuristics, as opposed to something that's pluggable. Do you think that that's still scalable in the future, as opposed to having some for all the different range of systems to simply have heuristics to map a range versus independent implementations for a single API that would have much more radical difference in behavior?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So it's very difficult to have a single algorithm which works for all. Of course, it's very difficult. But we try to have exactly that. So the idea is to, for example, never try to use fixed numbers. So when we have to invent these heuristics and manage and tune these heuristics and find out what's worthwhile to keep, which algorithms are really universally going to work anywhere, one of the things which are very important is not to put fixed numbers in these algorithms, because fixed numbers tend to be like creating and opening the door for corner cases. So you really know when an algorithm is clean and it's going to work when it doesn't depend on a single specific size of anything. So yes, it's a very difficult problem, but that's exactly what we try to do, to try to have an algorithm which is not pluggable, but it can be tuned, like, for example, the swappiness, but it's still the same thing, just different tune. So it's challenging, but currently, I think it's working very well. If you see how things are going from cell phones to supercomputers with these kind of algorithms, I don't think we are at the point where we need to have anything pluggable, and we have something which works very well.
Kernel same page merging. I was originally familiar with memory deduplication from VMware, and I wasn't aware that anything else ever implemented it. Are you aware that any other operating system has implemented that? And also, are you aware of anything like a patent encumbrance that would apply to kernel same page merging?
Can you repeat the last part of the question?
A patent encumbrance on kernel same page merging or any kind of a patent.
Just wanted to be sure I understood right. So actually, we have in the kernel of Linux different algorithms than the one implemented in VMware covered by their own parent. So our algorithm is using arbitrees. It's using a stable and unstable arbitree, using the property of the arbitree where its balancing is independent by the value of the index. So effectively, the index in the arbitree of KSM is the page of the data. Check if we have to put the next page on the right side or the left side inside the tree while we walk it to do an insertion or a lookup. We do a mem compare, physical mem compare between the two pages. And that's while the memory itself can change. The new page, the candidate page, gets compared to the already existing KSM page. It's not write protected until after we decided it's the same and it's worth protecting and it's worth merging. So effectively, we are using something completely different than the hash that is in the patent of VMware. And we invented it. And I think it works better. And of course, in our implementation, there's nothing about virtual machines because we are using the KVM design. We just implemented KSM at the host level. The fact it works in the QEMU KVM process is just a detail for KSM. It doesn't even know about it. So the algorithm is completely agnostic. So I think the design is optimal. And with the latest innovation of KSM scale, we can also fire this KSM at full CPU load, even in very large system, and it's completely unintrusive and unmeasurable. You just notice that there's a lot more free memory. You just keep seeing the free memory going and up without downsides. So there's no problem with the panel.
Okay, if there are no more questions, I would just like you to remember we are changing the venue for if you want to talk with Andrea a little bit more. We are going to Jake Salone on 23rd and 7th, right? And now we're going on with the trivia. The rules are simple. We do this trivia, we can win some of the books there. We'll have 4 books today to give away. Andrea will ask some questions based on the talk. Please don't shout the question. Right away, raise your hand. I will pick the person I think raised the hand first. He can give a guess, and if he's successful, he will go on and choose a book. So, have the questions?
Okay, so let's try the first question. What's the most popular hypervisor used by the OpenStack user base?
There in the middle?
First, right? It was correct. The next question will be more difficult, though. So these are the 4 nice books. They're pretty heavy. So second question. THP, transparent huge pages, has been used in anonymous memory so far. So which next part of the kernel is going to use transparent huge pages?
Right here?
Correct. Let's try another question. What's the name of the 2 LLUs in the Linux virtual memory?
Back there? Active and inactive?
Correct. All right. Everybody has listened to the presentation. What's the size in bytes, well, the size of a transparent huge page or a huge page?
There?
Correct. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Andrea. Thank you all. See you at the next meeting.